Okay, so this build is something I've done purely for my own indulgence. That's evidenced by the fact that there are one too many radiators on the table in front of me. Try as I might, I could not resist that 980 Ti hybrid water-cooled card. Anyway, let's start assembling this PC, and while I'm at it, I will tell you something about the components. The motherboard is a no-frills but competent A320MK Prime from ASUS that I have retrofitted with VRM heatsinks for increased reliability and longevity. I originally had the B450 lined up for this, but I could not see the point in spending the extra. The SSD that I'm installing is an Intel 256 GB NVMe affair that is brand new. The RAM is a 16 GB kit of two 3000 Mbps Corsair DDR4 sticks, and the processor is a favorite of mine, the Ryzen 5 2600. As you might have already deduced, both the CPU and GPU will be water-cooled in their separate AIO loops. Oh, and somewhere in there I will chuck in a mechanical spinning drive for good measure. But before we go any further, we need to fix the case. I may try to shove 12 volts through 5 volts ARGB LEDs and unsurprisingly went poof. That is why you see me here hot gluing in place a 12 volts RGB strip. These are relatively inexpensive and mine came with both the controller and a remote, so in the absence of an RGB header on the motherboard, this is by far the best solution to granularly control the lighting in this machine. The case itself is nothing special, I'm afraid, a Corsair-y looking knockoff that originally came with ARGB. The weird thing about it is that the stamping quality is very good, but the coating is not great. Usually it's the other way around where companies don't give a damn about assembly tolerances, but they do strive to put a good looking coat of paint on. Surprising me that this one came with a few blotches from the factory. Guess you have to shell out considerably more to have both. Anyway, I will forgive that completely if it had any sort of air intake at the front. It has space for 3 fans but no vents or grills, so a ridiculously bad design that will unfortunately impact the radiator placements. Next, the PSU goes in, and if you think that 650 watts is extreme overkill, then think again, because that 980 Ti uses about 260 watts on the full load with frequent spikes, so a robust power supply is a must. This is one of my favorite PSUs because it is semi-modular, very reliable, decently priced around 60 quid when on deal, and does not include the troublesome 0 RPM mode that will inevitably break and turn the PSU into a howler. After quickly installing the fans, it's time to put the CPU 240mm water cooler in. This build, I've chosen a golden field cooler that is way, way, way more than the CPU needs, but it will definitely help to keep the overall noise levels in check. Because of the aforementioned limited airflow path in the case, I chose to mount this on top rather than in front and also set the fans as intake. Squirt of MX5 and the cooler simply clips into the AM4 bracket ears. It's not my favorite mounting mechanism, but it will do. And finally, the star of the show needs to go in. The gorgeous Inno3D GeForce GTX 980 Ti Isle Chill Block Accelero Hybrid S. I think someone in the marketing department got fired for that mouthful. Regardless of the name, it is one of the most premium Maxwell cards money can buy. It is pre-overclocked from the factory and the water cooler is very effective. Now, this card does draw in excess of 260 watts on the full load, and there is no way for me to control the fan as a functional GPU temperature without expensive workarounds, as the original fan would have been connected to the GPU block and controlled that way. But at some point in time, it was clearly replaced. I also have a feeling that the water cooler was also serviced because it performs impeccably, so I took the decision not to tear it down. Initially, I installed an Arctic Silent fan connected to 12 volts on the exhaust side as a failsafe in case the PWM fan linked to the CPU on the intake loses the profile I set, but that proved to be insufficient. I swapped the Arctic fan with the Corsair pressure optimized fan, and that made about a 12C difference, with the car topping out at 71C in a 19C room after 30 minutes, so I will definitely take that. You have to make a small sacrifice in the acoustic department, but it is not egregious, and I feel much better knowing there is no way for the car to cook itself due to shoddy fan profiles. So let's see what happens when we flick the switch, and...
Oh, shiny!
Well, it works as intended, and I think it stuck the landing. Have a look and judge for yourself. In the benchmark, we start as per usual with Heaven, the oldest and by far the most predictable benchmark that I regularly subject hardware to, so this makes it even more shocking when my reaction upon first seeing the results of the 980 Ti hybrid was HOLY. That is faster than a 1070 and by extension a 1660. I mean, I should not be that shocked considering they cost about the same, but still, in my head, Maxwell should be nowhere near Pascal or, God forbid, Turing. 159.4 FPS is about 1 FPS faster than a 1070 in the same conditions, but then again, this is a top-of-the-line water-cooled Maxwell generation card, with the 1070 being considerably down the product stack and not benefiting from the overkill cooling. Oh, and the 1070 uses a full 100 watts less power, while the 1660 is even lower than that. That really doesn't matter though, because this isn't going to data center, this is going in someone's, well, office I guess. So I think this PC is the first serious contender as best value PC I ever built. Not necessarily the absolute cheapest, but good enough to dethrone my previous best effort that sported an R9 280 and an i5 6th gen core CPU that was just insane value for under £300. This won't end up quite that cheap, I'm sure, but it will be very competitive. Following on with the comparable to the 1070 logic, the 980 Ti again bested it by about 3 FPS in superposition. Not a huge margin, but a win nonetheless. Now I would like to point out that these benchmarks do not necessarily aim to fix in place as many variables as possible. Even the Windows install, if I am being honest, is an old junker that needs refreshing, but it is indicative of real-world worst-case scenarios, and I am just fine with that for the moment. It has been pointed out to me recently that I should try to make these benchmarks more scientific, and my initial plan was to work my way to that, considering I have the skills and knowledge to do it. But the more I go into that direction, I find it is less and less representative. My aim isn't to scientifically and reproducibly benchmark these components, that has already been done. My aim is to find out if in a real world scenario this is or is not an objectively good gaming machine. And side note, up to this point it's been brilliant. Okay, enough palaver, let's get down to the first real game, and that is Rocket League. As usual, on machines that have a decent GPU installed, I go straight for the highest settings at 1080p, and this time is no exception. The frame rate hovers around 300 FPS, and all I can say is that as far as I can detect, on a 120Hz monitor, the experience is flawless. Continuing with esports, Fortnite is next, and for the first time I start with optimized medium plus epic draw distance settings and no resolution scaling, giving us a very good average of around 120 FPS, staying mostly on the good side of 110. Going full bore with everything on epic halves that average FPS to about 60, but surprisingly the frame times are still reasonably tight, so if you have a 60Hz monitor, then epic is a valid option, depending on how competitive you are. Horizon Zero Dawn at ultimate quality posts 63 FPS average in the benchmark, a situation far more demanding than normal gameplay. If it was me, I would just turn on VSync and proceed to thoroughly enjoy the game with all the eye candy it has on offer. Lowering the settings will provide a lot more FPS, sure, but I am not convinced it will impact the experience much. In Warzone, I left the settings untouched from their defaults detected for the hardware because I thought that high is, well, sensible. The footage I am showing you here is from the intro because I didn't think that playing through a capture card online would be a very nice thing to do to other players. But the overall FPS over two very poor matches on my side was 78, which I think is a good enough number considering the settings and the tight frame times. Reaching 144 FPS in this title is easy enough, and if you want even more, FidelityFX is there. That's more of a test for lower end hardware because this can handle 1080p just fine without any resolution trickery. In Assassin's Creed, I am always wary about how hardware will perform. Using the high preset, we get 59 FPS, which means in regular gameplay, we'll enjoy over 60 the vast majority of the time. Considering the game just shed over 30GB in a recent patch, I have no clue how this compares to previous runs anymore. What did strike out at me was that the CPU performed very well, almost on par with the newer 3600X. Speaking of the CPU, if there ever was a title that I was worried it would bottleneck, that title is Days Gone. Happy to report though that no issues were detected even with the silly ultra high preset keeping around 64 FPS on average with occasional dips to the high 50s but only when changing zones. Going for the far more sensible high preset will alleviate most of the dips and elevate the average by another 14 FPS so it will stop it going below 60. I was a bit taken by surprise by the result because on previous benchmark runs with the 2600X I did see some CPU induced stutter, so I temporarily replaced the RAM kit with a slower 2400 Mbps one and sure enough it started to misbehave, so well done fast RAM I guess? I've owned Far Cry for a while now but I haven't played it yet. I do intend to do it in the near future though, so I only ran the included benchmark and not dived into any gameplay. Considering what I know about the franchise and the massive emphasis previous installments put on the CPU, I was well pleased with 63 FPS on average. I will need to dig into this a bit more because I'm still confused why both the CPU usage and power is low with the GPU mirroring this behavior. I have a funny feeling that Ubisoft again delivered a single-threaded bound game, as it's the only thing that would explain why the hardware is so underutilized. But forgetting that for a minute, today we end on a high note with Cyberpunk. The configuration to me screamed optimized medium settings and it does not disappoint. With the medium preset though, the average stabilized around 57 FPS after 10 minutes of downtown driving, but with a bit more care taken while fiddling with the settings, over 60 with very good quality is easily achievable. Heck, even Ultra is playable with around 36 FPS and no egregious frame drops. Well, that's it for today's video. Thank you very much for bearing with till the end. Have a lovely day and see you in the next one.